and another hustle double. Right over the bag at first. Now Hosey and Anderson square off. They're fighting. They're swinging. Down goes Anderson. Down goes Anderson.
This is Chicago. Doors open on the left at Chicago.
Welcome to Chicago. Welcome to Chicago. Welcome to Chicago.
This is
welcome,
Chicago. Welcome, doors welcome, open welcome, on the left welcome, at Chicago.
Welcome, welcome, welcome. Welcome to Chicago, coming from the 606 Media Studios. That's right. This is the
two places right now.
Yeah, two places. This is the TCSF podcast with Big Z and filling in again as co-host. It is Ivan. Oh, no, Ivan's not here yet. Stevie-B from the No Water in the Weekend podcast. Ivan should join us shortly, hopefully, if he gets on the call. Episode 155 is brought to you by 606 Media, true Chicago sports fans, and Grit Clothing Company. Don't forget to go to gritclothingco.com and get your official TCSF podcast t-shirt and search for keyword true Chicago. Use our promo code TrueFan15 for 15% off your entire order. And that is TrueFan15. Go and get your official shirts now. What's up, ladies and gentlemen? Welcome to the show. If it's your first time or you're a long timer, please remember to hit that subscribe button.
Smash.
There you go. And that notify button. And go ahead and give us a review on your listening app of choice. You can find us on Facebook at True Chicago Fans. You can find us on IG at True Chicago Sports Fans. You can find me at 606 Media Group or Big Z underscore 606 Media Group on IG as well. And then if you want to follow Steven over here.
Yeah, it's nowhere on the weekend, but it's spelled WKND, so be sure to check us out. It's new episodes every Monday.
All right,
don't forget you can support the show with a monthly subscription at anchor.fm/TrueChicagoSportsFans. Go over there and click and support, and you can subscribe as low as 99 cents a month. That's right, 99 cents. Help us out. If you make you laugh, if you make you cry, but please, yes. Do you like the show?
I sure do.
Are you a fan?
Always.
So tell your friends and then they'll tell their friends. We can all be best friends. If you enjoy the content, again, if we make you laugh or cry or yell or just think, please share with others, and we would like to do that as well. What up, Z? How's your week? How you been?
Oh,
we're
man,
this through Skype.
Yeah, this sounds kind of funny. If you guys don't know, sometimes we got to do it through Zoom because of availability and so forth. But if he sounds kind of nasally over there, it's because we're on the Zoom. It's been a crazy week. I mean, I did your show over there on Friday. It was a good time, about two hours worth of show. Tons of fun. And then, what did I do? Went over to Cuba 312, had some dinner out there. Let's see. I literally been cleaning. You give me some shit about cleaning. I do have a lot of clutter. I have a lot of shit. I literally have my teaching stuff for PE, for health, and then I have all my sports stuff, all my clothes, and it's a lot right now, so I'm really getting ahead of it. I threw out a lot of stuff. I sold some furniture this weekend, which is great.
Nice.
Yeah, I bowled very well this weekend as well, so I don't even want to get into the scores because I want to upset the bowling gods, but I did okay, and I look forward to finish up the season. But other than that, it's really been just watching a lot of sports. A lot of big news has happened this week, whether it's in Chicago or nationwide. But you know what? It's nothing too spectacular. Just living life, man. How about you?
You know, it's funny because it's August already, and then we're getting into fall, and it's like this summer went by far the fastest for me, right? But today I was actually at the Cubs game, so if I sound a little bit more happy or joyous and really into the jolly spirits, because I was there today. I was at the Catalina Club.
The Catalina Club?
Yeah. So you're upstairs on the fifth floor, and it's all you could drink and all you could eat. Not like 1914, but it's like beer, wine, seltzers.
So
if you want hard liquor, it's a little bit extra, but yeah.
So you were at the Catalina Wine Mixer, is what you're saying?
I was, and it was just as fun. It's the freaking Catalina Wine Mixer. Yeah, so I had a good time. I was at the game. It was a blast. I'm still wearing my hat. I had my jersey on, but it was a great time, a lot of fun, even though it was drizzling a little bit. But I could go inside or outside. So I had some hot dogs, burgers, ice cream, a couple of seltzers, a couple of Malort shots. So That was good. That was fun.
Wow, that sounds like it's an appointment for the toilet.
I mean, I'm pretty good right now. I mean, those bathrooms were pretty busy. So.
Oh, you didn't have a private bathroom? Okay.
No, I mean, you have three stalls, and then you have two urinals, but at the same time, it's like, you know, you gotta wait, or like if the Cubs are batting, then you go to the bathroom. Like, that's how you do the process.
Yeah, that's right.
A little bit. So, but it was good, and we'll talk a little bit more, but I got to see Justin Steele. I don't think I've ever seen him pitch before, so I thought that was pretty cool.
Okay, all right.
So, in this episode, we will talk about the amazing Chicago Cubs and the demise of the Chicago White Sox. The Bears making some impressions. Great signings, much more, and stirring the pots and what you're looking at, but let's get started.
Yeah, let's get started. I know it's going to be a little different format today just because we're doing it on Zoom, and it's kind of hard because we can't talk over each other. We got to take turns talking. So if it sounds a little weird, a little different, this is the reason why. It's stupid Zoom. So you know what? It's been a crazy couple of weeks here in Chicago baseball-wise. We had trades. The Cubs have been hot. They took care of business against Cincinnati and now Atlanta. So it's been a great couple of weeks. If you're a Cub fan and if you're a Sox fan, your season's over and you're waiting for Bears to start, and that's pretty much what's going on. So Steven, what's going on with the Cubbies, man?
All right, man, we're back. We are freaking back. I'm telling you, I've been saying this the whole time on the show that we're back, and to be excited and to love this team because everyone's on a hot hitting streak. The pitching's been good. Defense has been amazing, and it's been a fun team. Right now, the Cubs have been they've won 13 of the last 16. We're in the wild card spot now, and we're 2.5 from first place in the division. Now, you know, we've had many discussions on this podcast, and you've always said, hey, they're an average team. Well, right now, they're not looking like an average team. They're hitting, I think the run score like 2-3 days ago, or maybe even a week ago, was like 150 scored runs. Yeah. And you have Baltimore, the Rangers, like 106, 107. So we're like we're more than the AL, and the AL is so stacked and dominant with great pitching and hitting. So it's nice to see that the NL is doing really well for the Cubs, at least.
Yeah, the Cubs have been really red hot lately for the past couple of weeks, and then you guys have been like have the most run scored since the All-Star break. Your run differential is pretty high. It was an average team. I don't know what the catalyst was to make the Cubs a cohesive team to be a contender, but they're right now, what you have to say is they are a contender to win the NL Central. They are 1.5 back. Who do you guys play next? I think it's the, if I remember correctly, it might be the you got the Mets, the lonely Mets. This is
Mets, and then we got the White Sox coming in.
You got the Mets, Blue Jays, then White Sox.
Right.
Yeah. So, I mean, the Mets is a series that you can, it's a three game series. I'm sorry. Those are three games that you easily sweep. But the problem with the Cubs is they always lose the first game. And you know what? That may be something that, you know, I mean, it's going to happen. You're not going to win every single game. But the Cubs, I think right now it's time to put the pedal to the metal and say, hey, every single game is game 7 of a World Series. We need to get this division. Don't worry about the wild card. Let the chips fall, you know, let them stand where they fall at the end of the season. If you're a wild card, then that's fine. But what you want to do is you want to take this Central that's been lackluster, you know, just like the AL Central has been super lackluster. It's time to, you know, put it all together. This team is fun to watch. It is a must-see TV. If you can get to it, if you go to the bar to go watch them, because that's the only way I can watch them is going to the bar. But, yeah, so, you know, and I know the new marquee thing came out, but I'm not paying for that shit. But the Cubs right now are fun to watch. They're a team that even if they're down 8-0, you don't feel like, oh man, this game is over. You're like, well, you know what? The Cubs, will, you know, they'll chip away, and they'll come back with a lead, and that's what they're doing. It's a fun team to watch. Bellinger, one of my favorite players, because he was a Dodger. He came through today. He came through when Atlanta was threatening. And I'm telling you right now, right, the Cubs better re-sign this kid.
And he's worth the money, 100% worth the money. And second, how, like the last couple of weeks, maybe 2 weeks, to get people out at home plate. Today was an example. We got another person out at home plate. They did it with the White Sox. They did it with, I believe, Cincinnati. And then they did it with the Atlanta Braves today. Getting people out from being in the outfield, throwing it home. And it's not even just one specific player. It's everyone in the defense knows it's like, hey, let's try to get it out at the plate. Forget the cutout man and just bomb it. And then we've been getting great, like, throws, perfect throws. And you're getting players out at home base by a mile or by really close, but it's just great to see that defense along with the hitting. And I'm so happy with this team. And, like, again, you know, they're not average, but they're fun to watch. And they're meshing. They're connecting with each other. And it's like, again, kickstart your heart, put the pedal to the metal, like you said, and just keep going.
Yeah, and right now what you have to do is you have to praise your general manager and your president of team operations over there up at Wrigley, just because they've been doing a pretty good job. They made some small trades. They didn't trade away, because, you know, we were all on the fence, like, oh, do you trade Stroman? Do you trade Bellinger? If you're, you know, they were under 500 at that point. And now that they've made this push and they said to the front office, no, we want to stay together and we want to see what we can do. And they've been showing the Chicago Cubs fans, the administration, and the nation that they're coming for that center, and they're coming for your team. They're not a team that's, you know, to be dealt with lightly. I know their record right now is 4 games over .500, but last 10 are 7-3. Like you said, 13 out of 16. I mean, they just took down the Braves 2 out of 3, who have won 70 games right now, who are 10.5 above the Phillies. And the Phillies have been doing pretty well as well. And right now it's a very winnable Central division. And if you can get in, you can make noise. This happened with other teams. I think the Phillies and the Nationals had a similar record when they went on their run, where they were under 500 before the All-Star break and they went on a run. All you need is to get into the playoffs and you can make noise, and anything can happen, because somebody from the Braves can get hurt, or somebody from the Dodgers can get hurt, or the Giants or the Diamondbacks, whoever it may be. The Diamondbacks have just fallen apart. Speaking of the, you know, you know, we're the hot team. Right now you have the Dodgers and the West at 63-46, and you have the Atlanta Braves at 70-39. Those are the two teams that I think you should be worried about the most once you go into the playoffs. If you win the Central, then you're a home team, you know, depending on who you're gonna face. You know, if you
wild card, you could go against the Braves, you could go against the Phillies.
Right.
You might steal 1 or 2 games, but it all comes down to pitching, experience, and many things that go into factor with playing, you know, postseason baseball. But I would like to think that we would chip maybe win 1 game. It's not like the 2000s where the Cubs would get to the playoffs and get swept all the time. So,
yeah, I mean, what it looks like right now, let's say it is the Braves. And see who would win the wild card. It would be between the Giants and it would be between the Phillies. So one of those two teams. So the Braves would face the wild card. So it would be the Braves or the Phillies. And then you guys would be playing the Dodgers.
We beat the Dodgers. The Dodgers have beaten us. So it's like, it's up in the air. And of course, you're going to wear your Dodgers gear. And, you know, we're going to go watch.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, 100%. I will buy more Dodger gear because I am no longer buying any White Sox gear the rest of the year. The rest of the year, I am no longer buying. I have not worn anything White Sox since I said it last episode. And I probably won't wear anything White Sox until September, until I'm done mourning.
I mean, hey, no, I get it. But we can talk and jump into bed, or if you want to keep talking about how great the Cubs are and, you know, make me smile a little bit more, because I do love that, man.
I bet you do.
I do love it. And listening to that, I'm sorry, Steven, you are right. I'm sorry for making fun of you. I listen to that every single morning, and it makes my day a little bit better every day. I'm gloating because I've been really persistent on my calls and what I've seen and my statements. And I've been, you know, I would say 70% of the time right of when I'm making these calls and these things.
Hey, man. I just say put your money where your mouth is and start betting on the online bets and see what you can do, because if you're on a hot streak like right now, just keep it going.
So, I had put like $5 to have just a steal, have more than 5 strikeouts, and it paid out $6. Boom, little bets like that.
It's okay.
Like, you know.
You got to build it.
It is what it is, exactly. So I'm excited for this team. I love this team. Any chance I get to, you know, watch this team, I'm like there, seeing at the bars. You had mentioned the app for Marquee, and I haven't even seen it yet. And I don't know what the price is. Do we know the price of it?
You know what? I can pull it up as we're talking. But I did see it because my Fire Stick, my Fire Cube updated. So it came up. The logo came up there. So let's see. Go ahead.
I haven't seen it yet. I would like to get it, but I want to know how much it is. Because I got to cut something, man. I got to cut Amazon TV, or I got to cut something. But if I'm able to watch these Cubs play and even go to the postseason a little bit,
all right,
I'm okay with it.
All right. So the direct-to-consumer subscription.
Yes. So I had mentioned on the pod that the Yankees were $25 and the Red Sox were $30. And we were trying to figure out what the Cubs are going to be. I would assume it's like $34 for the Cubs.
No. It's actually $19.99 per month. And I think it's this cheap because it's so late in the season, because you're only going to get 2 months worth of baseball, August and September. Because any playoffs is not going to be on Marquee. It's going to be on TNT or TBS. It's going to be on TBS or Fox. Those are the two channels it's on. So it is. That's probably why it's so cheap right now.
I'll give that $20 then.
There you go, $20.
I'm going to get the Marquee right now at this podcast and then just watch the games coming up.
All right, share your password so I can watch the Cubs too.
If they're able to share, I'll share.
I'm pretty sure you could. All right, so we do some White Sox.
Let's talk about the great White Sox. White Sox.
I do have that sounder. Let me. You know what? I do have that sounder. So you know what? Just for shits and giggles, I am going to play that White Sox. Where is it at?
It's somewhere in there.
Yeah, it's in there. There. Here.
I've been
there.
There you go. White Sox. Go, go, White Sox.
Let's go, 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 White Sox. Yeah, there it is. Yeah, so, you know.
I think that was the last time they're actually good.
Shut up. Oh, Jesus. Wrong button there. I'm acting like Sean, which buttons are just clicking.
Yeah, no. Don't do that.
Yeah, thanks, Cubs. Yeah, sure, Benetti. It has been a wild week with the White Sox, and you know what? There was better boxing action there than there was on the pay-per-views with Jake Paul and Nate Diaz. I did watch that fight, and I thought it was just a money grab, really, because Nate Diaz had no business being in there. But the shot heard around the world, and let's listen to it.
Double right over the bag at first. Now Hosey and Anderson square off. They're fighting. They're swinging. Down goes Anderson.
Watch your mouth, cabrón.
Exactly. Thank you, Martin. You know what? I know the genesis of this. This stems over from the game before, where there was a, I can't remember the runner was coming into second, and he, Tim Anderson, tagged him and lifted up his hand and tagged him again, and the ump called him out and they reviewed it, and the play stood. Jose took exception to it, said he's not playing the game the right way and he's playing dirty and whatever. So when this happened, they had words about it, and you guys saw the clip. I mean, I posted about 8 clips of it on our page, because why not? I posted the 2002 fight night with him with his gloves up. I literally posted a bunch of stuff. The one with the UFC with Joe Rogan and all the guys like reacting all crazy. I went ham. I was like, fuck it, make fun of my team, why not?
But also, the part that I got a little bit annoyed is because like they compared that fight to, I hate saying it,
when Jose Bautista, yeah,
when he had knocked out, and I'm just like,
yeah, but Bautista got knocked out. Tim Anderson got knocked down and then got back up.
Oh, I mean, I've been just watching until he got knocked down.
Yeah, well,
he did make contact. I think when Bautista got hit, he was just, you know, getting hit for a little bit.
Yeah,
and he didn't like fall, but his helmet was there. Yeah. But I did find out what Tim Anderson ate before he went to the game.
What was that?
A knuckle sandwich.
Wow, now you got dad jokes. All right.
No, Wow, it's a good joke.
That's what he had during the game.
He had that before the game, and he had definitely one after the game on the Knuckle Sandwich.
And it's crazy because why am I losing names here? Jose Ramirez, right? Jose Ramirez was in the lineup the next day, which was today. We're recording on Sunday, and Tim Anderson wasn't in the lineup.
Yeah,
that made no sense. That made no sense. But that's a managerial thing, and I think the manager got into a fight. Eloy got strained something. He strained his vagina. I don't know what he did, but he got hurt. Selby Zavala on a 10-day injured list with a strained oblique. This is not because of the fight, but this is a strained oblique, so he'll be on there for 10 days. They brought up Carlos Perez from AAA. A kid that's not ready to play in the major leagues, but we've got no one else to play there. We did take 2 of 3 from Cleveland, which is great because they should not won today. They came back in the 9th. I actually was about to bet against them.
I did bet against them.
Well, yeah.
I lost. And I was like, this inning, it was like $5 for like $16. And I was like, oh, I'm going to bet. I made the bet. And then I look at it again. And I'm like, wait, why did I lose? I'm like, oh, the White Sox came back and won. And I'm like, there goes my money.
Yeah, I lost the bet because I did bet against the White Sox on Saturday. And, you know, I was like, oh, they're up. I'm going to bet on Cleveland to win. And that didn't work out too well. But it is what it is. You know, the White Sox are, that's what they're going to do. They're going to disappoint you, whether you bet against them or bet on them.
They keep screwing me over, even though they're not even winning.
They're like, oh, Ivan bet on me? Oh, yeah. Yes. We're going to lose. We got the Yankees, who are also a big disappointment coming into town. I think that stadium's going to be full because there's a lot of New Yorkers here, just like when Boston comes in. Right. And then, you know, we got the Red Hot Cubs coming in for the second round of the Crosstown Classic. So are you excited about that?
You still need to wear your Cubs hat.
Right? Yeah. I wanted to do it with Ivan in studio, but he couldn't be in studio today. So that's why I said I will pay my debt. I pay all my debts. So I will wear my hat, my Cubs hat next time.
Where are we going for dinner?
I told you we're going to go to Offset.
Okay. Oh, and then we didn't go there, I was going to say I want that chicken breaded steak sandwich.
Oh, Rico Betty's?
Yeah.
All right. I mean, that works too.
I want it to be also like a Chicago themed
okay.
kind of dinner.
Either one works for me.
Do you like Rico Benny's?
I love Rico Benny's.
Okay.
It's a heart attack sandwich, but yeah, I love Rico Benny's.
Well, let's die.
All right. You know what? I got nothing else to say about the White Sox because I don't want to get my heart pressure up. I don't want to be all out of control. I'm just saying, you know what? It's nice to have the Cubs win and a winning streak. They're doing well. Congratulations to my Cubs fans who are actually happy right now. Hey. Yeah, I do have any applause button. Yes, I do. I do have an applause button. I could do that right here.
Sorry. Yeah, congratulations. Hey, go on now.
I'll put it on for next week. But let's take a quick break and then we'll get Ivan on. Ivan Vargas from the Tape Never Lies Network, and we'll talk some Bears. So we'll be right back after a word from our sponsor.
Hey, true Chicago sports fans, show off your Chicago pride with some fresh clothes from Grit Clothing Company. At Grit Clothing, they create that simple yet classic style that represents that Chicago Southside lifestyle. From t-shirts to hoodies, hats to glassware, they've got you covered. Grit has everything you need to represent your Chicago pride, so do it right now. Check out gritclothingco.com and use the promo code TRUEFAN15.
TRUEFAN15.
For 15% off your entire order. Let me say it again. That's gritclothingco.com and use the promo code TRUEFAN15 for 15% off of your entire order.
What up? It's Martin Moreno, and you are listening to True Chicago Sports Fans Podcast.
Welcome back to the True Chicago Sports Fan Podcast with Big Z. And now we have Steven and we have Ivan from the Tape Never Lies Network. Thanks for joining us. I know we had some technical difficulties, but I know you're super elated, Ivan, about your Cubbies. So we want to hear what you want to say about the Cubbies, and I know you got a lot to say about the White Sox. So we'll give you the floor for a couple minutes. Go ahead, go.
Okay. Quickly. Cubs, I was totally wrong about the Cubs because last show I was sitting here and I'm like, man, I think they're done. I don't know if they have enough. And lo and behold, 13 to 16 games, they've won. It's, I love what they're doing. I love how they're trending. I want to see it go as far as it can. Do I think it's a World Series team? I still don't, but I think it's a playoff team, man. I think it's a playoff team, and you never know what happens once you get into the tournament. So we'll see what happens with them. But God, on the South Side.
Do you want to play the clip for you? I'll play the clip
oh,
for you.
Oh my God! You can play the clip over.
I want you to play. I want to play the clip because you know what? If I can't make fun of my own team, right. Who can? Right. So let me play the clip again for you, so you can enjoy this.
And another hustle double, right over the bag at first. Now Hosey and Anderson square off. They're fighting. They're swinging. Down goes Anderson. Anderson.
I'm going to tell you, and you know what? I think I heard the broadcast for the White Sox, I think once, maybe twice, but this right. version of it is way better.
Right. Oh, dude, like, honestly, I didn't even see it live. I didn't know until my buddy just posted something. I found out from Facebook, like everybody else probably did.
Right.
Your social media, you found out. I'm sitting here, I'm like, man, dude, how in the world did this little 5'9", 180-something-pound pudge reach Tim Anderson? I was like, Tim, you got a lot of reach. You got a lot of range. Like, how did he go ahead? Then I saw the tape. And Tim, on top of everything, man, you need to put up a guard. You need to put up a guard, and you need to be prepared. You swung wildly twice and missed.
Yeah.
And then he just connected with you. Look, as bad as it's been for the White Sox, we don't need to start physically beating them up, all right? Everybody in the major leagues, don't start physically beating them up. This we'll have to report you at that point, okay? Just keep it to baseball, and everything will be all right.
This team is already demoralized. There's no reason to rub it in already. Tim's a studio gangster. He's tough. He's a keyboard warrior. Like, you're going to start trying to start a fight and then get knocked out?
First of all, that was the... Honestly, I'll give them my respect to the both of them for squaring up.
Yes.
And honestly, I've never seen that shit in my life.
Never.
The umpire took off and said, let him go.
Yeah, he said, put his hands up and move back. Yeah.
I was like, what is he doing? Yeah, I was like, what is he doing? And then they just squared up. I'll give them the respect for doing that. But after that, Tim, like, on top of everything that's been going on, that was not a good look. Not a good look. And then you're out. You're out of the next game while Jose Ramirez is fine. You know what I'm saying? Like
he got a standing ovation today.
Did he?
He got a standing ovation when they were back at Cleveland today. And when he got up to the bat, everyone was clapping.
Oh, for Jose. Yeah, for Jose. Yeah, that made no sense why Tim wasn't in the lineup. It's not like he hurt his hand.
No.
No, but he hurt his jaw.
Yeah, he hurt his jaw. Oh. Dude, he was wild. There was a couple angles. Because there's some people that were like, oh, Tim just got right back up. I'm like, no, Tim did not just get right back up, Doug. I was like, Tim did not just get right back up.
No, he didn't pop up right up. He was down. He was like dazed. And then he's like trying to get him. They picked him up.
Yeah, and then they had to grab him because like Tim had no legs. That's why. Like there was a couple people around him because Tim couldn't really. You could see it. He's trying to get his legs back under him. To be honest with you, man, there was four White Sox players around Jose Ramirez before his punch got off, and none of them stopped that shit. None of them grabbed him.
No, but it's like a hockey fight. It's like a hockey fight.
I get it.
You throw your gloves down. Hey, me and you're gonna throw down. All right, everybody, move out the way.
No, I get it, but it's not hockey. That's the thing. That's the thing. It started like a hockey fight, but when you have two clubhouses, you know, going at each other, and you got two guys on the team, it's all of a sudden everybody's trying to protect, you know, their guy. But, you know, long story short, I'm going to leave it like this. Cubs love it. The White Sox, bro, I'm going to take a vacation from talking so much crap. I'm going to take a vacation because at this point, it's like, it's not fun.
It really isn't. It really isn't because this team is already buried 6 feet deep. Mm-hmm. We got issues with
the horse is dead.
Oh, the horse has been dead. No need to beat it. I mean, you got I forgot the name of the, whatever the word is, the certainty or whatever that word is, where you got GMs going over Rick Hahn's head and calling Kenny like, hey, I need this player. I'm going to make this trade. And you go over Rick Hahn. Rick Hahn, at this point, you have to leave. You have to leave. You have no authority. If the owner is saying, no, I want this guy as a manager, if people are making trades over your head, what is that telling you? That means that no one has a clear path of who's running the damn team. If I'm Rick Hahn, I'm leaving. Well, there's no point in being here.
Rick should have been like, I'm out, as soon as they hired the manager he did not want.
Uh-huh. Yeah, the Detroit manager.
Yeah, no, both of them. But both, Brandon, not the Detroit manager. He wanted AJ Hinch,
right. But
what did he get? He got old Uncle Tony.
Yep.
You know what I mean? So
yeah. Uncle Tony.
And then when he wanted Bruce Bochy, and they're like, well, we're not going to pay all this money to Tony La Russa and to a new manager. So then we got, you know, bargain shop.
Right.
Anyways, let's talk about...
Let's go positive things.
Let's go positive, and let's talk about the Bears. I know you were there today, so bring us up to speed.
Dude, so honestly, I was just kind of hanging out with the fam today over at Bears Family Fest. It was raining, you know, it kind of sucked the weather-wise, but honestly, everybody, the vibe there was pretty up. Everybody was upbeat. Everybody, obviously, you want to see number one. You want to see the offense. You want to see how this team is coming together. Like I said, for the most part today, I watched a little bit of the 11-on-11s at the end of the practice. But I was trying to keep up with my son. Like, he was just going crazy in the stands and stuff. So like I'm trying. It was family fest. So like I brought the family, yeah. And it was just with the kids. It was a lot. But from what I saw, like I said, it's going to be a one week at a time, one month at a time. You could even take it into quarters if you want to go every 4 weeks, every month, and try to assess the Bears like that. Because I think if you go jump into it and you expect them to be some world beaters on offense, or you expect them to be perfect, you're gonna end up just pissing yourself off. You're gonna end up frustrating yourself. You're gonna end up thinking that this team is something that they're not right now. You know, something that they're not right now, because you know, throughout the NFL season, a team could start off a certain way, but then they build and they change and they become something different. So I'm just saying, the Bears, don't be too high, don't be too low. Just take it week by week and enjoy the process, because I think this Bears team is on the right direction, headed towards the right direction.
I completely agree with you. Hold on.
I agree with that.
Let me get it, and then you can get your point in. I went to go see Paul. I'm bad with names today. Jesus, again. Nate Diaz fight.
Okay?
I was at Hawkeyes. And it's funny because I wasn't really in. I was like, oh, I'm just going to go to Hawkeyes. I'm going to get some wings. And they're like, oh, we have the fight. Cool, whatever. And I'm wearing my Bear shirt. I'm wearing some orange shoes. I got black pants on. So I look like a damn coach, right? And so this dude comes up to me. He's like, with a White Sox. He's like, how? What do you think the Bears are going to do? I'm like, 6-7 games at most. He's like, you're crazy, man. They're going to win 10, 11 games. I'm like, can you tell me why? And he just turned around. I'm like, okay, so you're a meathead. You're a meathead.
Right.
This team won 3 games.
10, 11 games? Yeah, come on now.
I mean, I know you've been smoking stuff, but Jesus, lay off it. And this team is going to have to take baby steps in growth. This is his second season with the same offense. Now he's got a bunch of new parts added to his car. Like, he's got to figure out how to use these parts. They made a couple signings, you know, they brought in Mercedes Lewis, who's going to be there just to block. And people are like, oh, he's going to take away from Cole Kmet. And no, he's just there to block. He needs somebody to cover his ass. That is it. And people don't understand that it's going to take time for him to get cohesiveness with the rest of the group. But you know what? What do I know? I just run a podcast and we talk about the Bears for 4 years. Take it, like you said, I agree with you. Take it by quarters, because every quarter this team is going to progress either up or down, or it may be a roller coaster. So, Steven, go ahead.
So, I agree with you, and I can agree with you, both you in some sense. Expect disappointment and you'll never be disappointed is my always saying when it comes to Chicago teams. But I feel a little bit different. I know the Bears have a slightly easy schedule than it was last year. I know last season we ran it back between me and you, and we guessed how many games the Bears would win or lose. So me and you both had a little bit of a disagreement on how many games. But I mean, you're starting with the three preseason games. You're going to, you know, Packers, Buccaneers, Chiefs, Broncos. You got the Commanders, Vikings, Raiders, Chargers, Saints, Panthers. So you're like, it looks like it's easy on paper, but it's really not. And for you to say that they're going to win 6-7 games is logical in some sense because, hey, you know, I could see us beating the Packers and beating the Buccaneers, but the Chiefs, not a chance. I would bet so much on like the Chiefs with that. Broncos, they're figuring out their own stuff. And then with the Commanders, that's an easy win. But again, at the same time, it's like you don't know what to expect. Yes, they are meshing together and they're hitting their stride. You know, they're hanging out. They're like, you know, communicating. They're, you know, always practicing together. So, I mean, I'm excited to see them. I also feel like it's like the Cubs team. Like, right, you see them making pieces. You see them making choices and smart decisions. You don't expect them to win, you know, the Super Bowl, but you're making the right stride to getting there and getting to that finish line of winning a Super Bowl. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah. If you want to talk quarters, let's talk about the first quarter of their games. They play the Packers at home and they open the season. Right. That should be a win. There should be no reason you lose that game. You're at home. You have the momentum of the fans and the excitement. If you just stick to your game plan, you don't have to overdo it. The Packers are not that good of a team. They had a horrible defense last year. They don't have their quarterback this year to save them, to put up the points. This is a game that you should win against the Buccaneers. Right. I don't even know who the quarterback for the Buccaneers is right now.
No, the Buccaneers.
So right now, it should be a win. But you're going, it's split between, what's his face from Cleveland?
Baker Mayfield and the kid from Florida. He's not a kid, but he's like a second-year player. He's from Florida, though. Kyle Trask.
Yeah. Baker should retire because if you can't be the starter for the Buccaneers, blah, blah, blah. We're getting off topic, but... yeah, that should be two wins right there. The Chiefs, if you win that, that's a great upset, but I doubt that. That's if Patrick has the flu or is not even playing, right? That's an automatic loss in my book. And then with the Broncos, you know, you have whatever is going on over there. But, you know, you can see yourself at 2-2 if you want to really think about it. But again, it's like magic's yes, they're going to be a fun team to watch. They could be like the Cubs, or they could just, you know, win a couple upsets, win this. But it's like all going uphill from here. I don't expect them to be the last and win three games. But, you know,
I agree. I expect the progress to be like just incremental, not some crazy jump from 3 to 12.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like the 12. It's just, it doesn't make sense to me. Even with the soft schedule, you do have a soft schedule. So there is something to back up, you know, the thought of, hey, man, maybe this team could go ahead and overachieve and get double-digit wins. But, like, you also have to think, like, this defense and this offensive line still have to, like, they still have to prove something. They still have to go out there and show something. And with, you know, with that, I could see this team maybe reaching 9 wins. And that's like a hard, like to me, that's if all goes well, you reach 9 wins and you're fighting for a playoff spot. Like maybe you don't reach the playoffs, but you're like fighting for a playoff spot.
Right.
I don't see this team being, you know, a division runaway winner or a team that should be getting a bye in the first round of the playoffs. It just doesn't make sense.
No,
I don't think so either. I mean, go ahead, Jose.
No, what I'm looking at the schedule. Just, you know, I know we talked about the first quarter, but if you look at the tough matchups, I believe the Broncos will be a tough matchup. I believe the Vikings will be a tough matchup. The Chargers are a tough matchup. The Lions will be a tough matchup. And then, I mean, other than that, maybe the Falcons. I don't know what's going on with the Falcons because they were a hot mess last year, but the Browns are a better team.
Watson has been looking not so great.
Yeah, but they have a really good defense and they can run the ball. So they don't really have to rely on Deshaun Watson. So, I mean, the Cardinals are a hot mess. They lost their receiver. Their quarterback is hurt or whatever. He's playing Fortnite or whatever. I don't even know what he's doing. The Packers.
Okay, Fortnite's really cool.
I know. That's a shot at you.
Here we go.
right. The Panthers should be a win. You know, The Raiders should be a win. The Saints should be a win. I mean, there's a lot of those games. I think the Saints will be closer, but I think the Bears should beat them. But like you said, there's a lot of – it's a soft schedule, but you still have to play them. We beat San Francisco. We had no business beating San Francisco last year.
No. And that was a monsoon. Trey Lance, you don't know who your quarterback was. Well, their quarterback was Garoppolo, but that's another story. I understand what you're saying. I could see it being a lot closer than other people. Because, you know, from the outside looking in, you know, to like, you're like, oh, this team and this team are trash, right? But you don't know if that team just matches up well scheme wise or whatever against the Bears 1 week,
right?
Or if the Bears, you know, down in the middle of the year, they're down, God forbid, a D tackle, a starting corner, and a linebacker or something
right.
like that.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, or they're left, you know, one of the offensive linemen. Please, like, God, don't get, like, you just don't know what the hell's gonna happen. So the assumption that the Bears, are going to go ahead and like just beat these teams. It's like, this is the NFL, bro. And I know you could call a team trash, but any team could beat any team any given Sunday. It's the truth. And I know it's a cliche and it's oversaid, but if you don't have your shit ready to go, you're going to get beat flat out. So if the Bears, like I said, the top end, nine wins. And if they overachieve, maybe a 10th. And I don't even see that as realistic. No. I don't see double digits as realistic. Realistic would be 7.
And that's what Vegas has them at, 7.5 wins. Mm-hmm. You know, like you said, if it's more than 7, I think that's a great progression. That's a winning season.
Four wins in the NFL. Four games in the NFL. Four wins.
It's 4-5 in game improvement. That's a big deal for a team that's building towards a championship. I really think that, you know, the window's opening up this year, and next year they're a contender. That's what you want to do. You want to build towards the future and have sustained success. Now, they're bringing in veterans to help you out. They're all on one-year deals. Speaking of one-year deals, they signed,
Yannick Ngakoue.
Ngakoue. I got the last name right. Yeah, one-year deal with the Bears this past Friday. And, you know, that's a great deal. He's not a run stopper. What is it? Yeah, he's a pass stopper, right?
He's a pass rusher.
Right. So he's there for third down or second long or whatever it is. But he had like the more shitload of sacks, and people were like,
he's averaged about like 9 sacks like since he's been in the league like every year. Yeah. Like he's had it's consistency. So consistency at the position is what you got for a year.
Right.
I mean, you look back, you're looking at his track record. It says that every year he's going to get a sack. It doesn't matter what team he's been on. He's been on a few teams already.
Four
teams. So it doesn't really – the team doesn't matter, the scenario. He's going to go get 4 sacks or 9 to 10 sacks plus. So I'm down with it. I'm good with it. Don't look at it as this guy's going to be a staple, but he might be just a stopgap for something, you know, better in the future.
Right. The one thing that I want to say is, like, I'll bring up 2016 Cubs. 14 and 15, they got a little bit closer, right, to winning that World Series. I like to see the same thing with the Bears. Yeah, we're making baby steps, a little bit of progress, right? They win more than 3 games. Maybe they'll win 7, or maybe next year they win 10. Whatever the case may be, again, with the NFL, it's harder to, like, turn a team around with a couple of different players. Yes, you could have undrafted picks. You could do all that. But, you know, baby steps. I would assume they're above 500 team. I would like to see that. But again, spread disappointment, never be disappointed. I think, you know, you're going to see some highlights, some great plays, have fun with this team. But, you know, I feel like a lot of people in the media are going to say it's just appeals to quarterback. I feel like if they're losing, that's going to be the number one topic. And it's like, I get it. You know, he's year 3. It's a new offense. He has better pieces. But that's the one thing I don't want to hear. If they lose to the Green Bay Packers the next day,
I totally agree. I don't want to hear that shit either. But it'll be how they lose, because, like, if Justin throws 3 picks and they lose, Justin, you threw 3 picks,
right?
You know what I mean? If they're terrible, you know what I mean. But if they go ahead and they're losing, like, let's say they, you know, hopefully not lose 5 in a row, and they're losing five. They lost five in a row, but they scored 35 points each game.
I'll take it.
You know what I mean? And yeah, I'll take it. Like, you're gonna be like, okay, there's a huge positive on offense. You know what I'm saying? But we're losing by a touchdown. The defense isn't holding up. That'll be the caveat to that. If Justin's fucking up, hell yeah, you can't just not blame him. But if it's something different where it's like, this isn't on Justin like it was last year with the offensive line just allowing him to be beaten, mm-hmm. you know what I'm saying? Right. Like, then it's, yeah.
Yeah, again, last year was last year. They lost games by a touchdown or a point or a field goal. They were close games with a half-assed team that they got rid of they cut out all the fat. They said, we're going to do this. We're gonna tank. Hey, let's see what you guys got. And they almost won a lot of games. Now you have a lot of players that you drafted, that you signed. You have positions that have a lot better depth now. You have to see some improvement. And again, we're not saying they're going to be 10-7. They're going to be 7-10, maybe 8-9.
It'd be great to have 10-7, you know what I mean?
It would be great. It definitely would be great. But what I do want to see is I want to see fight. And I don't want to see the old school Bears offense. Oh, we're going to run it down their throats. No, man, that doesn't work anymore. We're not trying to win.
Walter Payton right there behind.
Right
behind Ivan.
Walter Payton would be scoring four touchdowns a game, every game. I mean, that's what he would be doing because he was just a huge athlete. But what I'm saying is that we're not in that old school mentality anymore. It is a passing offense NFL. And we have to be able to score 30-35 points a game to win and to be up there with the echelon, like with the Kansas City, right? That's what you want to be. You want to be a great passing offense that when you look at them, when you're watching the 11-on-11, like, I was talking about, you see that, like, oh, wow, look at all this spacing. Look at when they run their routes. There's not crowding and you're not, messing up with someone else's route. Because that's what I see with the Bears when they're running on offense. It's like, everyone's on one side. It looks like all the defense is ganged up in one part of the field, and that's exactly where they're throwing the ball. That's not successful. So I want to see a Kansas City style offense where it's open, where option one, nope, can't do it. Option two, nope, can't do it. All right, let's dump it off to the tight end or to the running back and let him get 10 or 15 yards because the defense has already been stretched because we have Claypool and we have Mooney that are going to move those guys all the way back, giving our short guys some space to get 15 yards. That's what I want. If we can't get the home run, that's fine. Give me a double. And fucking make them bleed by paper cuts.
Right. No, the thing is that we got to – and I want to – and I'm not – like, dude, Justin's my guy. Like, I already got two Justin jerseys, so I'm a Justin believer. But, like, if it doesn't go right, if it's very ugly, just maybe halfway through the season, don't be surprised to start hearing the rumors about next year's draft.
Right, because you got no pick.
You got two big quarterbacks, and you still have to get lucky. With the Panthers, not being good, you as a franchise still have to play your game and not try to tank because you're beyond that now. Like, you can't tank mm-hmm. here. Like, this isn't a tanking season. Like, we have to go ahead and we have to try to progress as a football team, not only as individuals at quarterback, at running back, or whatever, but we need to progress as a whole, as a team, with wins. Wins is the name of the game. So I don't see them, I don't see them screwing around if Justin isn't the guy. I really don't see them screwing around because they've already put some pretty good pieces together on this team and they're starting to build that defense. So if they have any inkling that he's not the guy, it's going to be a different story. There's going to be a change.
Yeah, well, what do we have? Nathan Peterman and...
Oh, it might not be in the middle of the season, but it might be like I'm talking about next year.
Oh,
they
yeah.
might be like, hey, we have to go ahead and
change
maybe
direction.
Rethink what we're doing here at quarterback. And like I said, that's like the worst case scenario.
Mm-hmm.
But you have to be aware that, man, if he does shit the bed, dude, like we're in a world of hurt.
Yeah, because I mean, everyone last year was like offensive line. Well, you got him that. Then you got him a weapon. okay, so now you have the offensive line and defensive line. And it's like, okay, so if it's not that, then it's the actual quarterback in this situation.
Then at the, that point,
but again, I don't want to hear those talks right away after the first two.
Yeah, at that point, you're the Raiders or the Indianapolis Colts. Now you're searching for a quarterback to fit into this team that's ready to win. And that's hard to do. It's hard to do to get a veteran quarterback to jump in into a deep pool of, hey, this is what we got, and you got to make it work or else you're gone too. And that's super hard.
I think I think with the first week, if the Bears lose, you'll get the biggest overreaction
100%
ever. And I'm talking about bigger than any overreaction I think we've seen in a while. It'll be fans calling for firings of people. There would be huge chaos. Like, it'll be anarchy in Chicago for week one, and probably until the Bears get a little bit of a winning streak. So I think, and I'm going to go out on a limb and say, I think it's the most important first game of the year, not only because it's the Packers, but because what it means, like the direction you're trying to take. Game one, beat the Packers, get that monkey off your back because you haven't beat them in God knows how long. And then let's see how you progress forward.
And that's why Lovey is so well loved, because he said, we're going to beat the Packers, and then we're going to win the division, and then we'll go to the playoffs. Mm-hmm. And he delivered on all of those things. So right. I mean, if you say you're going to beat the Packers as a coach, and that's a number one priority, the fans are going to be on your side. Because no matter what, if both of our teams suck, or if we suck, or they suck, and you got to beat the Packers. I mean, that's literally what you have to do, is beat the Packers. Now, the rest of the games, like I know, we talked about, the Lions are going to be a tough team. They're up and coming. And then you got one of the most prolific offense besides Kansas City in Minnesota Vikings. So it's going to be a great season. But I agree with Ivan. It is going to be the radio waves and internet is going to blow up if we lose that first game.
Yeah, I agree.
Did you guys hear about the Claypool and Jackson heated exchange?
Mm-hmm. No, I did not. Was that today?
No, that was the other day.
Yeah, it was yesterday. To be honest, I like it. Like, so I don't hate it. I don't hate it as long as they don't try to, like, you know, really go at each other. But hey, you can't control them. You know what I'm saying? We've heard all the stories with Olin and Fred Miller. And you know, other stories beyond that, but I don't hate it. Like I said, the energy on the defense is different this year, and I know it's just training camp, it was just practice, but they've been at it. They've been hungry. They've been flying. They've been really, you know, aggressive on defense. Like, it hasn't been just like a cakewalk where they're just going through the motions or just trying to get through training camp. Like, they're really working. And I think the offense notices that. And Justin has already had mentioned that in one of his, you know, post-practice pressers, is that, you know, that offense needs to catch that defense's energy. Mm-hmm. You have to match that energy. And I think the defense is just flying high right now, man. I think that they're young. I say it like this, and I don't want people to take me out of context, but they're young, they're dumb, and they just don't understand what's going on. Like, they're ready to hit and play some football. Like, that's what they're there to do. And that could be some recipe for success.
It sure can, because you're not thinking, you're not overthinking. You're just like, hey, I'm worried about my assignment. If the ball comes this way, I'm going to go for it. I'm going to go get that interception. And he got intercepted three times. I think it might have been Wednesday or Thursday's practice. And they're talking about, well, the defense is up there, and the offense needs to catch up. And if they can do that, the defense can do that to our offense. What are other defenses going to do to our offense then?
Right. I also think that it's a positive. Justin mentioned it such, like, it, you know, iron sharpens iron in a sense. But, like, you know, you have to start executing if you're the offense. Like, yeah, it's good that, like, you're getting a tough defense. You're facing a really tough defense week in and week out. But you have to start executing. Like, in practice and in the preseason. Yeah, you have to help the defense out. At the same time, in practice, you got to go out there and try to you know, get a couple on them. And they have here and there, but
yeah,
for the most part, it's been all defense.
I mean, on offense, their mentality should be like, we're going to embarrass these guys. That should be the mentality. Right. We're going to go out there with a killer instinct, and we're going to embarrass these guys. Yes, they're your teammates. You know, when practice is over, you're back to being teammates. And when you're playing a game, you're a teammate. But, at practice, at training camp, I want to embarrass the shit out of this defense. Yeah. Hey, Claypool, hey, we're not going to run what's on this plate. This is what we're going to run. If he has to call an audible like that, and
you can't do that in practice. But if they call a play for you, make the fucking play. Claypool this year has it is training camp, but he's been the one. He's been making some big plays downfield along with the other receivers, but he's been really standing out because we were talking about last time, like, you know, where the fuck is Claypool? They're putting him on the pup list. They're doing all these things. And, you know,
he's at
a fashion show. It's like, is he in shape? And I got to give him credit. Like, he's been showing up. Like, he's been showing up and showing out. It might have taken a little bit, but, you know, the practices that I've been, even the last pass I saw before we left today was a completed pass to Chase Claypool. I believe it could have been a cross or a deep out. I didn't really tell at first. I just kind of like looked up, saw it, and was gone. But he's been out there. He's been making plays. You got to give him some credit, man.
Yeah. No, it's going to be exciting to watch.
Yeah. Well, we have football going from this weekend all the way through January. So yeah, this is our time. This is our prime time. So I'm excited to what is going to come up with the Bears. I'm excited to hear what happens with the Bears offense. And I'm excited for preseason to start. All right, so some news broke as I'm editing. And some news broke from Jessie Rogers, the ESPN writer. This is coming out of New York. The White Sox have some issues. Surprise, surprise. They moved some veterans at the trade line. And it looks like the culture was toxic. What I mean by that, Keynan Middleton talked to Jessie Rogers and told him that there was a toxic culture with no rules that a rookie who I just found out was Gregory Santos was a rookie that was always falling asleep in the bullpen. Middleton was dealt to the Yankees before the Tuesday deadline and joined the White Sox this season after signing him for a minor league contract, one of the better relievers we've had. You know, so they flipped him, understandably. So do you think this is sour grapes? I don't. I really don't. I mean, you look at what's been going on. You've been watching the White Sox product. So if someone leaves and said, hey, you know what? It was toxic. Most of these veterans wanted to leave. Joe Kelly, Lance Lynn, all wanted to leave. Middleton said, we came in with no rules. I don't know how you police the culture if there's no rules or guidelines to follow because everyone is doing their own thing. Like, how do you say anything about it? Because there are no rules. You have rookies sleeping in the bullpen during the game. You have guys missing meetings. You have guys missing PFP or pitching fielding practices. And there are no consequences to any of this stuff. Multiple sources who corroborated Middleton's account to ESPN said a pitcher was seen napping during games as well as skipping fielding practice. When contacted Sunday night about Middleton's remarks, the White Sox said they had no comment. Of course. Why would you take accountability for this? Middleton was traded to the Yankees this past Tuesday for right-hander Juan Carrera, one of the five deals that they made, right? Middleton said, the second I found out I was traded, I shaved my face. I was ready to play by their rules because I know all I want to do is win games. You know how to act here. You don't know how to be late, and you know there's consequences if you are late. Yeah, the Yankees don't play. No facial hair. You can have a mustache. I think that's as far as you can go. I mean, the Yankees are an institution. They have a set of rules, and that's how you're going to play. Not with the White Sox, though. Middleton said that the problems at the White Sox predated his arrival this season, as well as Grafal's. The team finished 81-81 last year under La Russa before he left for quote-unquote health concerns. When I got to spring training, Middleton said, I heard a lot of the same stuff was happening last year, and it's happening again this year. Not sure how I can change it. They don't tell you not to miss PFS. They don't tell you not to miss meetings. But if it happens, it's just okay. I mean, what kind of culture is that? Holding no one accountable for doing their job. So now you can understand why these players are getting hurt. They're not practicing. They're not stretching. They don't take anything serious because they already got their bag. All these young kids that they signed early or these guys that they traded for, they already got their bag. And if there's no culture of winning, I'm getting paid anyways. It's disgusting. It is super disgusting to hear this. Obviously, we know the White Sox struggled early in the season, and they had injuries, and they had a tough schedule to start. The 10-game losing streak is a culmination of building this type of culture. If you don't stretch, you don't work out, you don't practice, you're going to play like crap. You're going to get hurt. It's very simple. Middleton said, I wouldn't say anything bad about the pitching staff. We went about our work the right way. The rest of the team struggled to do the right thing. I wonder who. Middleton cited players leaving for the World Baseball Classic, particularly Lynn and Graveman, during Grifols' first spring training, as one of the reasons the culture lagged. Other players and other teams left, and it didn't make a big difference. If you're trying to create culture, you need your big dogs, Middleton said. The guys who played in WBC were our big dogs, and those were the guys I felt like can't police things that are happening. Tim Anderson went too. Didn't Joe Kelly go? I mean, there was a lot of guys that went. Moncada, Eloy, Lou Bob, they all went. Middleton kept saying, there is no gelling of the team. We're supposed to find our identity in spring training so we can roll out for the season. If you don't find your identity, you're scuffling from day one. I can agree with that. But what did you try to do? Maybe talk to the manager. I don't know. I mean, I get what he's saying, but it's hard. It's hard. If there's a culture of not caring, of not doing what you're supposed to be doing, everyone's going to fall in line with that. I'm just going to do whatever I want to do. And I don't feel like going to the meeting. No, I'm going to stay out late. I'm going to miss practice in the morning. No one's going to say nothing. I'm getting my bag anyways. Middleton was asked where the voids exist with the White Sox. He said leadership in general. He says shit rolls downhill. I feel like some guys don't want to speak up when they should have. It's hard to police people when there are no rules. If you guys are doing things that you think are wrong, who is it wrong to? You? Them? It's anyone's judgment at that point. He continued to say, you hear about it before you come over here. I didn't want to shave my beard off. Hell no. I wanted to become part of the Yankees. There was no questions. And Middleton is showing up today, Monday, to play the White Sox at Guaranteed Rate Field. This is going to bring up a shitstorm. Who's gonna comment on this is my question. I mean, obviously, the pregame show for the White Sox is going to be can't miss. Whoop, sorry about that. It's going to be can't miss. But who's going to speak? Is it going to be Rick? Is it going to be Kenny? Is it the chairman, Jerry? Is he actually going to come out of his bat cave and actually speak on it? Or is he going to wait to the end of the season and say something in a presser or something? Because to be honest with you, he needs to come out and say, enough is enough. We're cleaning house. Rick, thank you. See you later. Kenny, thank you. See you later. Grifol, thank you. See you later. Everybody in the minors, thank you. See you later. Complete overhaul from top to bottom. Go get the Swiffer. Go get the magic erasers. Go get the pine saw. Go get the Clorox. Scrub the whole building down. Sage it. Go all the way down to the minors and do all that stuff to all those buildings, all the practice facilities, and start from the bottom. And build all the way to the top. That way you have the same culture going from single A, double A, triple A, major leagues. It should be one clear message of what we're trying to accomplish, and that's to win championships. If you are not here for that, we don't want you. It's as simple as that. If you're to get your bag, and not practice, not play, not take it serious, that's not the player we want here. The Yankees have standards for a reason. Boston, LA, they have standards for a reason. Big markets always have standards, and very high standards. And unfortunately, here in Chicago, the White Sox have bottom standards. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll be right back after a word from our sponsor, and it'll be stirring the pot. So we'll be right back.
Hey, true Chicago sports fans, show off your Chicago pride with some fresh clothes from Grit Clothing Company.
Grit Clothing Company.
At Grit Clothing, they create that simple yet classic style that represents that Chicago Southside lifestyle. From t-shirts to hoodies, hats to glassware, they've got you covered. Grit has everything you need to represent your Chicago pride. So do it right now. Check out gritclothingco.com and use the promo code TRUEFAN15.
TRUEFAN15.
For 15% off your entire order. Let me say it again. That's gritclothingco.com and use the promo code TRUEFAN15 for 15% off of your entire order.
Hey guys, it's Steven.
And this is Sean, and you are listening to True Chicago Sports Fans.
Don't forget to listen to No War on the Weekend. New episodes on Monday. You can find us anywhere you listen to podcasts.
Yeah, so we're going to go do a couple of shots. So let's kick it back over to Big Z.
No War on the Weekend.
Welcome back to the True Chicago Sports Fan Podcast with Big Z in the studio with us. It is Iron from the Tape Never Lies Network and Stevie-B from No Water on the Weekend. All right, fellas, it is that time again. You know what time it is. It's time for Stirring a Pot. Yeah, you bet you do. All right, so there was another call that went into the No Water on the Weekend podcast because I am not setting up a phone line. Because I already got enough shit from Cub fans. So there was another call that came in.
Yeah,
I already got two co-hosts right here that give me enough shit. That's all right. So there was another call that was on a No Water on the Weekend podcast. And, you know, I got to play this. I just really got to play this. All right, here you go.
I mentioned that this had something to do with there was some stuff on our voicemail that had to do with True Chicago Sports Fan. So I do want to play a True Chicago Sports Fan call that was left on our voicemail, because obviously
they don't have one.
TCSF doesn't have one.
They're behind a little bit.
They're broke. But so this is from that.
Hey, thanks for calling Noah on the Weekend Hotline.
So let's check it out.
Be sure to leave a message and take a shot, and we'll call you back.
Hey guys, I've been trying to reach Jose, but I can't seem to fucking get a hold of him. He won't answer any of my messages, or I add him on thread or whatever. But I just want to say I found your missing person. Your co-host, that's right, E-Rock, found him at a softball game. I fucking snatched him up. I put him in my trunk. If you ever want to see him again, it's going to be $150 cash up front. Get it? Yeah, so pass the message along to him, please. Thank you. Bye.
We'll pass the message
along. We'll pass it along, but I don't think Jose's going to go and get him.
I feel like the next episode of TCSF that comes out, I don't think there's going to be that co-host on there, but I don't know. My man, if you ever get out of that trunk, thoughts and prayers with you, but I'm not holding my breath. I don't know. Okay.
You know, do we have a hotline caller? I know you said you were busy this week. If we don't have one, that's fine.
I went through them, yeah. You want to hear that?
Yeah.
Yeah, if you didn't have time to listen to the hotline, that's fine, too. I know you're busy.
Oh, yeah, I did. I actually I was able to listen last night before I began stuff for today. But, yeah, let's check that out. Okay, so let's bring up this call here from
Hey, thanks
hotline.
For calling Noah on the Weekend Hotline. Be sure to leave a message and take a shot, and we'll call you back.
Hey, guys, this message is for Jose again. I just wanted to say, ha, 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 very fucking funny that you can play my last message on your show, but you don't have the balls to call me back.
And wow.
Come pick up your mansion, you know what I'm saying? So here's the deal. I got to get him out of here, you know what I'm saying? I mean, I can't do this anymore. He's chained up in my basement, but he's made fucking pinball machines out of everything in my fucking house at this point, okay? So I'm going, here's the one time off, okay? One time off, $150, fucking forget it. Let's drop that shit down to, I don't know, $75. Just 70, just, you know, fucking call me, man. My number just please call me.
Wow. Are you going to call him or what?
Wow.
75 bucks. It's not bad.
That's not a good deal. I mean,
I just spent my last 20 on ice cream, man.
Oh, that is true. But he's going to tip you 20. So then all you got to do is come up with 55.
Right.
And I know your girl's rich.
Yeah.
Okay. She could spot you.
She could spot me, but I don't think it's worth the investment.
Jeez.
The studio loves that.
I don't know.
He also didn't leave his number.
Well, oh, we have it. We have it. We have it here. Cool. Yeah. Or why are you going to text him? You're like, I can't do it.
Yeah, I'll text
him. Here we go with this call. Oh, that wasn't it.
Calling Noah on the weekend hotline. Be sure to leave a message and take a shot, and we'll call you back.
Hey, guys. Hey, Jose. It's me again, man.
Of course.
You know, you don't have to fucking pay me. Don't even fucking worry about it at this point. You know what I'm saying? You just come pick your dude up, okay? You know what I'm saying? It's just get him out of my fucking house. You know what I'm saying? Just please. Fucking hold on a second. Stop fucking stop touching my fucking baseball cards, Tom. No, stop. Get the fuck out of there. I know it's the cops. Please, guys. Yeah, I just, you know, I'll give you, you call me. The guys from New York, we can have my fucking phone number. It's okay. I'll give you fucking $75. No, I'll give you I'll give you $150. Please come and get him. I'll be here until tomorrow night. Okay, bye.
How the tides have turned.
Wow, he's going to give you $75 now. We don't have to do a GoFundMe anymore.
He said $75, and then he upped it to $150. So the original offer is you pay me $150 for your co-host. Now he's saying, I will give you $150 to pick this guy up.
Now all you need is another $50, and you can pay me.
That makes sense.
Yeah, I'll wait for the other
$50. I'm in danger.
I was a little bit reluctant to play this one.
Oh boy!
But I'm going to go ahead and play it because we have to wrap this up. We can't keep going on with this. And if this guy calls back again, he is not getting on the air. So let's go ahead and listen to this one.
Hey, thanks for calling Noah on the weekend hotline. Be sure to leave a message and take a shot, and we'll call you back.
This message is for Jose. This is the last message I'm going to leave you, okay? So, I mean, like, I tried. You pushed my hand. I didn't want to do this. You know what I'm saying? I didn't want to do this. But you have pushed me. And, I mean, oh, my God. I mean, listen to this fucking idiot back here. Listen, hey. You hear that? Fucking. Anyway. Fine, I didn't need your fucking $150 anyways, man. I didn't fucking need it, okay? You pushed my hand. Here we go.
Oh, no. Oh, no. Oh, no, 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 no. Oh, no. Oh, no. Oh, no, 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 no.
I'm sorry. You'll never hear from me again, I swear.
Whoa. That got dark.
Yeah, that pinball machine just stopped all of a sudden.
Yeah. Yeah.
Jose, how do you feel right now? You're crying.
I was laughing at the pinball machine in the background. Poor pinball machine got it in the head.
Oh, yeah. No.
And you just got a job, so you could have paid that $150. Yeah.
And you could have paid me.
A little boy. Late. I haven't got a paycheck yet. How am I supposed to pay you?
IOUs in the meantime.
Yeah,
you can't do paycheck loans in Chicago anymore, so that's a deal. But
Chicago Steakhouse sounds
so,
nice.
So that guy, he never gave us his name. Do not call back. I know he said he wasn't going to call back.
He doesn't have to anymore. The problem's solved.
Yeah, I don't know. I just keep, you know, see what they find behind the salt shed, I guess.
I mean, it's
kind of hard to drag a pinball machine like that.
Whoa.
So, yeah, this call, I told you, this caller has been nagging me about getting my old co-host and picking him up. But, you know, I'm unemployed at the moment. You know, I literally just got a job this week.
Yeah.
I literally just got
you
a job. Yeah, I got a
you
job this week. That. So, I forgot to mention that. I just literally just got a job this week. So, money's not coming in. Money's kind of tight. You know, I can't be just, you know, splurging on certain things. And, you know, he was for ransom. He wanted $150 or $175 bucks. I didn't have that kind of extra cash. So,
then it went to $75.
He did, but then he said it to 175 again on this call, and I'm like, well, why did it go back up? And then, you know, the defunct co-host was making pinball machines in his basement, and the guy couldn't take it anymore.
Yeah, that if you didn't hear that already, there was a gunshot at the end.
I don't know if there was a pinball machine that took it or he took it. I don't know.
I don't know.
No, depending on where he's standing, they both might have taken it.
Hey, right. It's kind of like Sopranos. It was kind of like Sopranos. They just went to black.
Yeah.
Anderson was seeing when he got knocked down.
He was seeing stars.
Not five stars, that's for sure.
All right. Give Ivan your joke.
All right, Ivan, so you weren't here at the beginning of the part. Afterwards, when Tim got up and, you know, he had to have dinner before he left and, you know, was like wanting to eat something because he played a really good game, in quotations. So he had to have his favorite meal. So he had a knuckle sandwich for dinner.
Nice. Oh.
I knew he would love it.
Look at Jose.
Fucking knew he would love it. Such a dad joke. It's one of those things you tell your second graders.
I don't care. I love it. I love every moment of this White Sox misery because I know you missed the first part, but have I not been on the right track of everything I've called so far?
I keep
telling you, keep betting then. Hey.
I've been betting and I've been, but it's like I get more satisfaction when I call it and it comes out right. And I just, I'm happy for myself because I could see it, maybe because I've been on True Chicago Sports for the last couple of weeks and yep. I feel like I'm an actual reporter and insider. but you know, I feel like I you know, you love baseball. I love baseball. I love baseball. And I'm like watching and listening and seeing it, but I'm like, I just, you know, again, Ivan, I listened to that clip. If you didn't listen to last week, be sure to go check out TCF Chicago last week where Ivan was like, the bet's off. Steven, you were right. I'm sorry for making fun of you. You were right. And I played that clip, and I clipped it, and I played it every morning before I go to work, especially on Mondays because it's the beginning of the week.
So I got to pay up my bet. I got to wear my Cubs hat. But I want to do it when you're in studio, yep, too, because you were there right. when I rescinded. So just to be fair and pay out my bet in front of both of you, I will wear my Cubs hat then.
You know what, Ivan, join us for dinner. Come with us and join us, and we'll, you know, we'll get some dinner. I would love to have another Cubs fan there. We'll wear our Cubs stuff, and then he'll have his Cubs hat on, and yeah, it'll be a good time.
Well, we can watch a Cubs game, too. The Cubs game has to be on, though.
Right. We'll go to Wrigley.
Fine. Oh, we don't have to go that far north, you know. But
no, Ivan just wants to rub it in.
I mean, I love that. I don't usually drive that far up north unless I'm going to the game. But you know, I'm down. Whatever you guys want. I said Rickabennies or something Chicago staple. That's all.
I mean, thin crust pizza is a Chicago staple. Italian beefs are a Chicago staple. I mean, there's a lot of food.
I can't have Italian beef. But
oh, that's right. You can't have the Italian beef. I don't know.
Yeah, I'll get food poisoning, and my body rejects it, and then I die, pretty much.
So Italian beef pizza
don't
it is.
Don't eat the Italian beef, Steven.
I mean, if I don't want to go to work tomorrow, I'll pretty much just, you know, eat the Italian beef and be like, I got food poisoning, and send a photo to my boss. Please, throw up.
Yeah, never market for like Al's Beef or something like that. Like it'll be
Al's terrible. Beef, Bona like, Beef, Patel's Al's Beef. Does not matter what
I can't
it is,
have it.
I still get sick. It's not anything against them. It's just my body cannot handle it. That's my kryptonite, and I'm sorry. So,
all right,
I'm Superman, but I'm not. You know, that's my kryptonite. So
that plush toilet seat is gonna take a beating.
But I'll be, if I'm there for a while, and we talked about it on Noah on the, oh yeah, we
talked about it on both shows, weekend, yeah.
But I'm just saying, if I'm going to be there for a while, I'm going to be comfortable.
Your ass is so sweaty. Oh, yeah. You better have a fan in there.
Hemorrhoids or not, I'm going to enjoy my time there.
You're going to drop 20 pounds and sweat 20 pounds.
Oh my God.
And plus, the way we got apps on the phone, it's easier to stay there longer now.
Oh, my God.
But also, Ivan, you have a wife and kid. It's like, that's your privacy. So, you know, get a cushioned seat, and that's your, like, little getaway for 15, 20 minutes.
Yeah, we had this conversation. I can't do the plush. I can't do the plush, man. Mm. The plush is just, like I said, it makes, honestly, it probably, like gives me a little burn too. Like if you get warm. Like, dude, you don't remember like the old school Jose knows what I'm talking about.
Yeah, the plastic on those couches.
If you sit on those old ass plush, and I'm sure they've been, you know, innovation has gone probably a long way. Like they probably, you know, have
leaps and bounds.
It's science, man. Leaps and bounds better. But I could just to me, what's the answer to the sweaty ass? None. There's no answer.
I don't have sweaty.
You're always gonna have a sweaty. Well, I'm gonna have a sweaty ass.
I'm at the shower right after.
You gotta shit before you go.
No, I'm at the shower after I sweat.
Yeah, well, you shower, you shit after you take a shower.
That's all wrong. But no, but I'm like, you know, you want to light a candle, have some great energy, and just, you know, do your business. It's the last great American thing we have in this country. So.
Yeah, I just can't do the plush. No plush.
That's two volts.
All right, well, both of you are not taking a shit at my place at the studio of Noah on the weekend. You're only taking pisses here. You want to take a shit, go downstairs with Sean.
Okay, we'll
don't
do
sit
that.
On, don't you sit on my fucking toilet. Don't you sit on my toilet. That's going to be Steven.
Yeah.
He's going to put a sign.
You don't like the cushion? Shit somewhere else. I'll think of a different segment.
Come up with a sign. All right. All right, Ivan, before we get out of here, what are you watching that's not sports?
Oh, bro. Damn. You know what? To be honest, I'm watching Lord of the Rings.
Oh, shit. Okay.
Yeah. Which one? I finished last night. I was able to finish, or actually this morning, I was able to finish The Fellowship. And then now I'm on Two Towers. And then I'm just going to do the backwards. I know it's not backwards because The Hobbit's actually first.
Right.
But I'm going to go the, you know, Peter Jackson trilogy, and then I'm going to go into the Hobbit trilogy.
Is this your first time watching?
No, not at all. No.
Sam Wise. I love you.
Honestly, like Sam just makes me upset sometimes. actually, majority of the times shut up, Sam. Like, why are you being so? Anyway, let me not go deep. But yeah, I'm watching The Lord of the Rings right now. So.
Oh, that's awesome. That's nice. Awesome. Steven, what are you watching? That's not sports.
All right. Well, so I've been watching a little bit of everything lately. So I was watching Futurama. The new season came out, so I've been watching that. Finishing up Detroiters, which is really good. And I finished, what is the show? The Fool, These Fools.
Oh, yeah.
It's on Hulu.
Yeah.
You know, it's a Latin culture, kind of LA vibe. I know you guys can't relate.
I can.
I'm just kidding. I'm kidding. But, yeah, you know, if you guys aren't, you know, you're not here with us, but Jose just did the LA kind of hand signal because he's a Blood or a Crypt, but we don't know in secret.
Depends on the day.
I mean, it's a great show. And I was getting so frustrated and so mad because like these hardcore Latina women are just being really mean. And I'm like fucking leave. I'm like, dude, you don't have to deal with that shit. I'm like, she's telling you that you're not a man and like she doesn't want to get married and have kids and you do. I'm like losing my mind over here. I'm like, I gotta push through. But I was just like, yeah. It's a great show. It's funny. And you know, there's certain things that I'm like, as a Hispanic man, Latino, I do get a little triggered by, but I mean, what Latino guy doesn't get triggered by your lady pushing your buttons if they're Latina? So I'll leave it at that.
If you want to send hate mail to Steven, his address is...
If you want to fight me, Latina women of the show, I will go toe-to-toe with you. Until you're like...
Oh, my God.
You know, go see Barbie.
Steven versus somebody's like, Wella, that's like pushing a cart. Like that'd be a fight. Like that those women's got to be like strong as shit.
No, I feel what I'm saying. Like, no, I respect that. I respect the umbrellas because there was a meme that I saw today. It's like there was this girl who was drinking beer. It's like, we don't want a girl who drinks like her dad. We want a girl who irons like my mom. Hmm. And I'm just I'm just like, oh.
I mean,
I like
It's the truth.
That by the sign always the back. It's like, if I'm going to get my shirts and stuff, I'm going to go to my mom's house and go, hey, can you wash 90s? And no problem. It's like, yeah, I'll do it. So,
or she could just iron them before she gets drunk.
Facts.
Whatever. But it's like, but if she does do it while she's drinking, you're going to have a hole in your shirt, like shirt or like pants
beer,
or whatever.
You have the beer there. Stain when you, when she puts it down on the shirt and shit.
No,
the
it's
ring.
The iron. The
no, I'm saying she's going to have the beer rings on it.
Oh my God. Yeah. So watch the show and comment and talk to me about it afterwards, I guess. So,
yeah. Yeah.
I love everyone, but geez, it's triggering. Jose, what are you watching?
You know what? I'm pushing through The Flash. I'm almost done with season 4. I think I'm on episode 20 or 21 of season 4. Pushing through. There's a lot of cameos. Danny Trejo just came out a couple times, and there's a lot of people that I've seen. What I don't like is, because I don't watch Arrow or Supergirl, that there was a crossover event, one of the Flashpoints, and because I don't watch the show, I've seen like the beginning of a war or the end of a war, and I'm not going to go watch the other stuff, so I can Google it or YouTube and figure it out. But other than that, I do want to watch That Fool that you were talking about, because I know it's a limited series. It's from like 8 episodes or something.
It's 10. It goes by really quick.
Yeah, it does. It's about 28 minutes. Right. Guardians of the Galaxy just dropped on Disney Plus. I'm going to rewatch it because I watch it through my Fire Stick, and that's not really the greatest quality of a movie, if you know what I'm talking about. And then what's the other thing? SummerSlam was just this weekend. I still haven't seen it. And one other thing. Oh, there's a movie with John Cena and Jackie Chan. It's going to be one of those guilty pleasure crappy movies.
Oh, I forgot to say, I saw Oppenheimer. I finally saw it.
What'd you think?
I saw it. I loved it. But, you know, if you're seeing it, and I'm a history buff and, you know, I love learning. I actually like watch the YouTube video of like all the history, the chemicals, atoms, the way how you're putting all this stuff together. And, you know, they should really censor that stuff on the internet because, you know, anyone could build an atomic bomb now. kidding. But no, it was great. I loved it.
I like how he kids about that, but not his other comments.
No. Because sometimes it's the truth in the other comments, but an atomic bomb is no joke. If you liked and watched the movie, check out Peaky Blinders, because my guy, Cecilia Murphy, is in there. He's a Peaky Blinder. After I left the show, they're like, oh my God, that the main lead was great. And I was saying, watch Peaky Blinders, watch Peaky Blinders, watch Peaky Blinders, like shoving it down their throat. But yeah, we could digress and talk about that off air, but I just wanted to bring...
That's awesome. Did you see?
Because I did finally see it, and it was the best 3 hours. And I didn't have to use the bathroom, so which is also great.
Awesome, Ivan. You seen Oppenheimer yet?
I loved it. I thought it was great.
Yeah, it's definitely one of those movies you do want to see.
Go see it.
Yeah,
But I would say do some kind of research.
Yeah.
Behind it, because you need to learn the mathematics, chemistry, the way atoms are split together, and the different ways of pressure when you're dropping a different altitude, and also like after the fact. Of Oppenheimer. So if you don't like chemistry or physics, like how I am with quantum mania and quantum physics, and how I study and do these things on a regular basis at night.
Shut up, you play Fortnite.
Or you could just go smoke some weed and just go watch Oppenheimer. Same thing. Same thing as what Stephen's doing.
Yeah, Stephen's you're watching, you, sm- you smoke weed.
Don't get bombed. Yeah,
you see numbers coming at you.
You see Florence Pugh coming at you. Yeah. That's what you see the most. But yeah, go check that out. DM me, tell me that I'm right again about the movie. So I'm flying high, baby. I'm on the sky. I'm right there with the sun. I'm not trying to fly too close, but I'm really happy, man. I'm gloating. I'm sorry.
No, you're fine. You're like fine. You should be happy. You Cub fans should be happy. I am not going to rain in your fucking parade. Hey, you're happy. I'm fine with it. The Cubs are playing good. I'm okay with you guys being be happy. Someone's got to be fucking happy in this podcast. And if it's 2 out of 3, I'm all right with it. I'm not going to be
a
bitter.
Well, not only that, but me making my calls.
They keep making money, man.
I love coming out here. I've been making money, man.
I'm not hating on people to make their money. Go ahead, make your money. I am not mad. Your money is your money. If you're winning and you're happy, I am happy. It doesn't bother me. You know?
Like it, I love it, baby.
Exactly. All right, y'all. That is it for today. Thank you for listening. A big thank you to our sponsor, 606 Media, True Chicago Sports Fans, and Grit Clothing Company. Don't forget to go to gritclothingco.com and get your official TCSF podcast t-shirt. Search for keyword True Chicago and use our promo code TrueFan15 at the checkout for 15% off your entire order. That is TrueFan15. Get your shirts now. Check out the rest of the 606 Media lineup. You heard them already here. Stevie B, the newest show in the 606 family, is in the Water in the Weekend with Steven and Sean, a pop culture forward podcast that dabbles in funny trivia, film, television, music, and Chicago-centric news and happenings. New episodes every single Monday. You heard the call. I'm gonna go back into editing. I'm gonna put all four calls on there to make it the whole story, so you guys know exactly what we're talking about, why we're laughing so hard. But
right.
Check them out. Also, you can check out Ivan Vargas on the Tape Never Lies Network. When is your show air?
Well, it's about to go down kind of big once the season starts off. We'll have a number of shows, but right now we're doing one day a week, Wednesday night, 7:30 Central Time. It's keeping it 100 on Wednesdays, and then BHL Bears Hour Live will be right after the Bears games once the regular season kicks off. Actually, I don't know if we're going to be doing any test runs during the preseason, okay. but if we do, just check it out. You know, Ivan V underscore TTNL on Twitter. Or X or whatever it is.
Yeah, it's X now. Yeah.
Ivan, are you going to have me and Jose over to do that after show and maybe watch the game with you sometime? No, I think that'd be fun.
Oh, I don't do like no. I only produce the after show.
Oh.
Right. Well, then I get on the
that
after
one,
show.
And then we'll all three of us do that.
Well, we could do an after show of an after game if you guys want to re-record or whatever. But
yeah. Late night,
it's up to you guys. Late night
and Big Z
Bears late three Bears late night.
There we go.
Yeah,
that
yeah.
Sounds like something from Halsted Street.
Yeah, isn't that a bar over there?
It's, right. The Wee Bear Bear. That's what we're going to be called.
All right, let's get out of here. Shout out to Ronesh Panic and Serious Beats for the custom made for the beats we played on today's show. Check out paniconthebeat.com for your moment merch and gear. Check us out on social media. You can find us at True Shy Fans on Twitter, X, and on TikTok. Yeah, find us on Facebook, IG, Spotify, and reach out to us on our email. Want to hear from you, stirring the pot, food recommendations, show recommendations, movie recommendations. We're at truechicagosportsfans@gmail.com. All right, y'all, for Stephen B. and Ivan Vargas, this is Big Z, and we'll see you next time for 156. Until then, be good to each other for the love of sports.
A few moments later.
You have a lot of incest.
That's real.
Shut your mouth.
Lover boy.
Nature versus Nurture Lodge. Nature always wins.
I think he's on steroids.
Hasta luego, amigos.
Show's over.